What we're going to be talking about in this video today is leather glue. Now, I think on all my videos, what glue are you using there? Is probably the second most asked question that I seem to get all the time. So in this video today, I want to talk to you about what glue I've used in the past, historically, what glue I'm looking at going forwards. And then we're going to see, you know, what's available on the market today, how to use it, how to store it, lots of tips and tricks. This video is probably going to end up being quite long, and the reason is that I want to pack as much information into the video as I can for you. Obviously, if you don't want to watch the video, you don't have to. But what I don't want to do is leave people with a million questions and then spend years trying to reply to comments. So if the video is quite long, then that's why. It's because I want to get all the information in that I've researched to try and give you a good reference point to start from. So when I first started leather work, which is over 10 years ago now, and I got all my initial tools and supplies and things together, the glue that had been recommended to me is something called Evo Stick Time Bond. So this is a solvent-based contact adhesive. I don't think it's specifically designed with leather workers in mind or anything like that, but obviously it can be used for leather. It came in a little blue tin, and it was fairly easy to get hold of because you could just go buy it in B&Q, which is kind of a big UK DIY chain, or other DIY shops would sell it. So it was fairly easy to get hold of, and it worked okay for the leather. So I used that for, I don't know, probably a couple of years or something like that. It never came with a brush or any sort of applicator, so I used to use just a little, you know, a paintbrush or something like that that I used to try and poke the glue on with. And I never found it all that easy to use, really. And as time moved on and I started looking at some more American videos and people, you know, making things in America, they often used to use what was called barge cement, which is still available now. I used to see people talking about barge cement all the time, and that just didn't exist in the UK. There was no, you know, there was no opportunity to buy that here. But what did become available, if I, let me find a tin, what did become available at some point was this, which is what's called Tanner's Bond contact cement. And I believe that what this is essentially a slightly toned down version of the barge cement, because the barge cement at the time had quite a lot of chemicals in it and things which were, you know, quite bad for you, and they made a slightly lower VOC version, which I believe is this. So what I did was I bought a tin of this to try it. I thought, this is a lot easier, it's got a brush in the lid which makes application a lot easier. I could buy it from Tandy, which was in Northampton in the UK at the time, and you know, I thought, this works really well, why have I been using the stuff in the blue tin? So I worked my way through the tin of this that I had, then when it ran out, I went to order some more from Tandy, and they said, oh, we've run out of that. And I said, oh, you know, do you know when you'll be getting some more in? And they said, no. So I didn't really understand at the time, but that was a little bit of a precursor to what we're leading up to in terms of the glue. So I can't remember quite what I did. I think I must have had some left, so I used whatever bit I had left at the time or something. And eventually, when that came back in stock at Tandy, I bought about 8 tins of it, because I remember thinking, you know, I've struggled to get hold of it, so I'll stock up on it. So I got these tins and I put them in the cupboard, and there they stayed. So, slightly suspiciously, this glue almost never seemed to be in stock in Tandy at the UK. Now, I had my little stash in the cupboard, so it didn't matter too much. But every time I, you know, tried to order a bit extra or made an inquiry, it was always the case that, oh, no, I'm sorry, that's not in stock at the moment. Never seemed to be able to get hold of it. And I never really quite understood why that was. So when Tandy Leather closed down in the UK, which I think was last year or the year before sometime, I went over to the Tandy shop in Manchester and I had a conversation with the manager there about, you know, various different things because the shop was closing. And one of the things that we got chatting about was the glue, because I'd said to him, you know, I don't suppose you've got any of the glue available, you know, because the shop was closing down and I was stocking up on things. And he said, no, we hardly ever have the glue. And I'd said to him, you know, why is it? Why can you never get hold of the glue? So essentially, Tandy were hardly ever sending it over to the UK because it would freeze and spoil. And that's why it was always hard to get hold of. So with Tandy Leather having closed down, obviously you can now just not get that at all, really. They won't ship it here from America. The other couple of Tandy resellers in the UK don't seem to have that glue. So that avenue is kind of closed off, you know. So whenever I get to the end of this, which I think's gone a bit funny anyway, essentially I'm out of that kind of glue. So the situation that I'm left in then is I either try and find another solvent-based kind of smelly contact adhesive like that one of a different kind, and it needs to be somewhere that can regularly supply it, or the question really is whether it's time to look towards the more modern glues, which are water-based glues, and that's really what this video is about today. We're going to look at the water-based ones, see what's available on the market, talk about whether they work as well, and think about whether that's really the way forwards for people who might be struggling to get hold of glue. So what we're saying essentially is that we've got two different types of glues. Both of the glues are contact adhesives in terms of you apply it to one surface, you apply it to the other surface, it's the same glue. So it's not a two-part glue like an epoxy, it's the same glue. You apply it to both surfaces, some drying time involved, and then you press and hammer those surfaces together, and that's how the glue is used. Okay, so they're both contact adhesives. But in terms of the formulation of those glues, as in what they're actually made out of, we've got the older style glues, which are solvent based, which have got various chemicals in that are potentially not very good for you. Then we've got the newer glues, which are water based, which don't have those harmful chemicals in, and obviously are going to be better for you. So let's just take a minute to directly compare some of the aspects of those two types of glues. So probably the most important thing to talk about is obviously the health issues. If you're using a solvent based glue, it's got various chemicals in which will vary by the brand, which can be quite bad for your health. Some of the really old school glues, like the old school barge cement, has got toluene and things like that in it. Toluene can, you know, it can give you headaches, it can be bad for your lungs, your liver, your kidneys. If you're exposed to enough of it, it can cause you serious damage. Obviously, in more modern times, I think even barge and companies like that have tried to move towards toluene-free glues. So they're really scaling that back. But even still, all of the solvent-based ones have some kind of chemicals in which are fairly bad for you. And also, they have health warnings on, and they say, you know, using a well-ventilated area or use of the respirator or something like that. But whether people actually do that is another matter. Here, for example, this room that we're in, which you've seen on the tours, is a tiny little room. It's not what you would call a well-ventilated room. I don't have some huge outbuilding like some people do that you work in as a massive workshop. It's just a tiny little room. It's part of the house, which means any smells and things that come off the chemicals then start to waft around the rest of the house and so on. So it's just not ideal. You know, in my environment, it's something that's really worth considering. And of course, if you're, you know, working in an industry where you're using these glues and you're exposed to something like that for 40 hours a week, there's a big difference between somebody who's a hobbyist who might do a couple of hours a week of leather work or something and might use the glue for a tiny fraction of that time. So the amount of exposure is always a consideration as well. But either way, there is a serious potential health aspect to using these more dangerous types of chemicals. So the second thing is the availability. As I've said, sometimes it's difficult to get hold of the more solvent-based glues to do with shipping and importing and those kind of things. Now, if you live in America, you can probably get hold of all of these kind of glues that are produced in America without any problems, and you've got that whole range of choice. If you're living somewhere like England, where I do, then you might find that your choice is a little bit more restricted. So depending on where you live, you might find different things are available to you, but you will probably find that the water-based glues are more readily available because they don't have such shipping restrictions on them. So the third thing to talk about is the kind of cleanup with the glues. The solvent-based glues can dry, obviously very hard and sticky. If you were to try and apply it with something like a brush, you would find that that brush would get quite, you know, gummed up and be a little bit difficult to clean. And we'll talk about application later on in the video. But the water-based glues, because it's water-based and you can clean with water, you'll find that the cleanup is quite a lot easier as well. It doesn't have quite, you know, quite the same difficulty in getting applicators clean. So the fourth thing is the shelf life. And this is one area in which these do vary quite a lot. So if you take a tin of the solvent based adhesive like this and you leave it sealed up, as I was told by Tandy, it doesn't really have a shelf life, you know, once it's, there's no air getting to it or anything like that. So if you were to buy a tin of this and, you know, keep it in the cupboard for 5 years and then get it out and open it, it should be good to go. There should be no real degradation of the glue during that time. Obviously, once you do open it up, it starts to, you know, get air in it and things, and it tends to blacken and so on. We're all aware of that. But in terms of leaving it somewhere or stockpiling it, then, you know, it's okay, really. You don't have that worry. The water-based glues have quite a strict shelf life. And one thing I will say is that I've been in direct contact with two of the companies that we're going to talk about. So, you know, this information that I'm giving you is direct from those manufacturers. It's not third or fourth hand information of Reddit or something. I've been speaking to the people at the companies to try and make sure I give you the correct information. So the EcoStick glue that we're going to talk about, the Intercom EcoStick, a little bit later on, Intercom told me that that has a shelf life of 9 months, and that is an open shelf life. That's from the manufacturing date. So if a pot of that glue rolls off their production line in January, in September time, it's gone off. It doesn't matter whether you've opened it, you haven't opened it, you're halfway through it or anything like that. Essentially, it just has a shelf life, like a cake or something, you know, so it's going to go off. They have said that you might be all right for a couple more months if it's stored at ideal temperatures and things, so really 9 to 11 months maximum. But certainly in under a year, you're going to find that glue has gone off. The Aquilim glue, which we're also going to talk about by Renia, they have said that they guarantee 12-month shelf life. Again, that's from the date of manufacture. But they have said that their glue will tend to be okay for up to a couple of years. So they give you a 12-month guarantee, but you know they don't really have any problems within that couple of years. So that does have a bit of a longer shelf life. But again, it's not something that you can just keep for years and years and years on end. So that's not such a problem really, but what you do need to do is make sure that when you're purchasing these water-based glues, you mark on the pot when you've purchased it so that you can be aware of any expiry date that it might have. So the fifth thing to talk about is if you need to thin down the glues. So with the solvent-based glue, like this one, you can buy a thinner for it, which I have here. And if you find that it thickens up too much, then you can put some of the thinner in it and thin it down and make it a little bit more runny again. But what you're using to thin it down is essentially more chemicals. So because it's solvent based, I'm not even exactly sure what's in this. I can look it up if you want to. You're adding chemicals to chemicals and mixing chemicals together. And obviously you need to do that quite carefully. But you do have the thinner available and that can be thinned as and when you need to. With the water-based glues, because they're water-based, if you need to thin them down, all you need to do is add water to them. It's as simple as that. It's a little bit like thinning water-based leather dyes, for example. The same thing applies to the glue. Then you just add the water into the glue. One thing to say is if you are going to do that, then you should use distilled water. The reason being that because these things are water-based, they can grow bacteria in them rather than being, you know, solvent-based. And occasionally you'll find people who say, I've opened up my pot of water-based glue or something and it's grown mould inside it and gone mouldy, or it's gone off in some way, because that is an environment where bacteria can grow. So we'll talk a little bit about that in terms of storage. But one thing to say is that you would want to add distilled water in there to thin it rather than tap water, because if you just add a little bit of tap water, there could be bacteria in there. So you would use the distilled water. So the last thing to compare there is just the application. So generally when you're applying the solvent-based glues, which are reasonably viscous, you know, they're quite thick, reasonably thick, generally you're just going to do that with a brush, either a separate brush, or these kind of little tins have a brush in the lid, which is very handy. And the brushes work absolutely fine for this kind of glue. Because the brush is captive in these cans as well, and it's inside, it doesn't have time to dry out and go sticky. So, you know, the brush just stays working quite well inside the can. But generally, everything is going to be by brush. The water-based glues, because they're a little bit thinner, you've got a variety of ways that you can apply them, which I'll demonstrate shortly. But you can apply them still with a brush if you want to. You can also use various kinds of spatulas. It's thin enough that if you needed to do a very large area, you could apply it with a roller. And also some of the companies, for example, Intercom, actually sell a spray system. So if you wanted to, or you were doing enough, you know, scale of production, then you can actually spray them essentially with a special kind of a spray gun, and that applies just the right amount as well. So in industrial applications, you would find that that's done probably more than in a hobbyist environment, but certainly the option is there if people need it. So the question then is really, if you've got these solvent-based glues and these water-based glues, which one is better? Is either of them better than the other? Is it a compromise to use one over the other, and so on? Because what you can see is that obviously there are a lot of advantages to the water-based glues, you know, in the health advantages and the application methods and the cleanliness of it and the availability and things like that. The question will be, why would anybody carry on using the solvent-based glues? And really, that comes down to a question of strength. That question that people always have is kind of, yeah, but is it as strong? Is it going to fail more easily? Is it going to come apart more easily? And I really don't think it's quite possible for me to answer that question in terms of yes or no. What I can say is that the companies themselves will say that the bonding strength is either as good or better than with solvent-based adhesives. This is people who sell water-based adhesives. You know, if you was to say to them, is it as strong? Then they're going to say, yes, it is. Anecdotally, you will find that a lot of people still maintain an impression that the solvent-based glues are a little bit stronger. And indeed, what a lot of people do is they keep both, if they can get both. And if they have a very kind of high stress area on an item or something that they think might need a bit of extra strength, then they may use the solvent-based, but for everyday use, they may use the water-based. So people have kind of partially moved over to the water-based, if you like. Certainly, there are lots of people out there, including some, you know, very high-end people who make, you know, really nice items, that are definitely using the water-based glues and don't seem to have any problems with them. I think if there was some kind of, you know, massive compromise to using the water-based glues, you would see a lot more complaints from people. Whereas if you, you know, want to Google around and read all different threads about it and stuff, generally people do seem to be happy with the water-based stuff. What I considered doing was to try and do some kind of testing in the video, you know, sort of sticking bits of leather together with the different glues and seeing how easily you can pick it apart and stuff. But it's just too subjective. It's not easy enough to test in a very, you know, scientific way, because the problem is that leather is fibrous. So it's not like sticking two pieces of wood or metal or plastic together. It is always just going to pull apart if you put enough pressure on it, because all you're going to do is pull those fibres off the surface. So it's too subjective to try and say, yeah, well, this pulled apart easier than that, really. But what I will say is that I have done some testing with the water-based glues and they seem absolutely fine to me. So what we'll talk about now is what glues are actually available on the market. Now, if you're watching this video years and years after it was produced, obviously things might have changed, such as the nature of the videos. But let's talk about what's actually available at the moment. And I've identified what seem to be the four main glues, water-based glues, that are available that people use. So I have been in contact with two of the manufacturers that I'm going to talk about now. So I have a little bit more information about those. Two of the manufacturers I haven't been in contact with, so I have less information about those. So the first company that I've been in contact with is a German company called Renia, or it might be Renia. I'm not exactly sure how it's pronounced. But they produce a glue, which is this one here, which is called Aquilim 315. This seems to be a very widely used glue. It seems very well respected. And I've not found really any instances of anybody having any complaints about this at all. In every case where I've found people saying they use it, they seem to be very happy with it. So this would certainly be one to recommend. I know that the Aquilim 315 is used a lot in the shoe industry. Now, many of the people watching this video won't be doing shoes, obviously, but one thing to take away from that is that obviously shoes come under a lot of, you know, wear and stress. If you're going to glue a shoe together, it needs to be glued well. So that should give you, obviously, some confidence in the strength of the glue and so on. So the second company that I've been in contact with are a company called Intercom, and they are based in Italy. And the primary product that people seem to be using from them is this, which is called 1816B. Now, Intercom do have quite a large range of glues. They've all just got numeric names, and I'm honestly not entirely sure of all the differences between them. So I would say if you want to try one, probably just stick to that 1816B initially. There is another one that I've seen mentioned from them, which is 1825, which I believe just might be a slightly stronger version of the 1816B. Now, I will also mention at this stage that Tandy do a water-based glue, which is called EcoWeld, or certainly it was whenever I bought this, if the name hasn't changed. And what you might notice is that the pots for the Intercom and the EcoWeld look very similar. And the reason for that is that this Tandy glue is actually made by Intercom. So Intercom provide two different of their glues to Tandy, one of which is the 1816B and one of which is a different product. And I'm not entirely sure which one's Tandy package in which way, but this is made by Intercom. So if you want to buy the Tandy EcoWeld, you are probably essentially buying the, you know, the 1816B or something equivalent of. That's not any kind of a secret, by the way. It does actually say on the label, if you read it closely enough, that it's made by Intercom, and the safety data sheet also confirms that as well. I have actually had this EcoWeld for far too long because I wasn't aware of these expiry dates on the glue until I started talking to the manufacturers either. So I have actually had this for about 5 or 6 years, which means it's well past its sell-by date. So now I've actually shown it to you on the video. It's going in the bin because it's actually no good anymore. So, but that's something to be aware of. If you want to buy from Tandy or you've got a local Tandy or something, you can buy theirs and you're still buying the Intercom glue. So the fourth company, and I'm a little bit confused as to the company name and the product name, but there's a French glue called Sarragum, however you pronounce it, 130. I'll call it Sarragum. So Sarragum 130, and that's available from a website which says Mando. I'm unsure whether Mando is the company, so I don't know whether it's Mando Sarragum 130 or whether they're just a reseller. I'm really not sure, but I couldn't find any really very much information about that, but I know some people do use it. Allegedly that's used by some of the high-end kind of luxury manufacturers. I presume they're referring to people like Gucci, Hermes and companies like that. Again, I'm not sure whether that's anecdotal information or whether it's true. You can't really just ring up Hermes and ask them what kind of glue they use. So I don't know where that's information to come from particularly, but I presume somebody at some point got some inside information on that. So I haven't tried any of that. I'm not quite sure where it would be available in the UK, but certainly that's something that people do use as well. So the fourth glue to mention is by Seiwa. Seiwa are a Japanese company. I use various Seiwa products like the pricking irons and things like that. Some of the finishes and other things that you can probably see behind me. Seiwa also do a water-based glue. Again, that's not something that I've tried, but probably if you're out in Asia, Japan, Korea, places like that, you might find that that's something that's available out there. I believe that Goods Japan will probably sell that as well because they sell a lot of Seiwa stuff. So that's something else that you could try as well. So that won't be an exhaustive list. I would think that there are other glues available. These are just the ones that I've researched. You've got the Renia Aquilim 315. You've got the Intercom EcoStick 1816B, which is also available as the Tandy one. You've got the Sarragum 130 and you've got the Seiwa glue. So if you're looking for a starting point, there's a place that you can start from, or you can see what's available in your own country. Okay, so what we'll do now is we'll jump down to the table and we'll have a little demonstration of how to use some of the glue, how to apply it, how to store it, and talk about how it's used, and it differs from using a solvent-based glue. So the first thing to say is that when you're using these water-based glues, there's two different applications that you can use, two different methods. The first method is what's called wet bonding, and then the second method is the essentially the normal way of using it, where you would apply it to both surfaces and then let it dry and then put the surfaces together. So what is the wet bonding first, and when might you want to use that? So let's imagine, for example, you might have something like a wallet that you're making. You might have a couple of card sections like this, and what you might want to do is put those together and then stitch them across. So you don't really need a lot of glue on there, because all you're trying to do is hold these two pieces together while you do a little bit of stitching. So if you're trying to assemble lots of card sections and you know you have to apply glue and wait, stick them together, do a bit of stitching, and then apply some more glue and wait and do some stitching, you find that it drags the process out a little bit. So if you're really wanting to just tack them in place while you do some stitching, then you can do that with the wet bonding. And all that means is that you're going to apply the glue to one surface rather than both. And then instead of leaving them to dry, as soon as you've applied that glue on there, you're just going to stick them together. That's going to give you enough of a bond to hold it in place while you do the stitching, and just lets you move on with your project. It isn't going to be suitable probably for a lot of highly finished leathers or chrome tan leathers, because you need to be able to essentially squash the glue into the surface of the leather, and also the water that's in the glue needs to be able to evaporate then out of the joint. So if you have a very sealed leather, again, you might find that that doesn't work. But for something like these pieces of kangaroo or something like that, that's vegetable tan kangaroo, it's not, you know, got any sort of very highly finished surface on it, then that would work fine. So that's your first application, is your wet bonding. But it's only for very specific things. You would never use that for something like an edge or a turnover or anything that was quite critical. It's just for tacking pieces together to allow you to gain a little bit of speed. So the first thing you're going to need to do is to actually prepare the leather surfaces to take the glue. And in terms of preparation, that's going to depend on what kind of leather it is. Some might not require any preparation, and then some might require some preparation. And what you then need to think about is the specific leather that you're using. So something like this, which is just a russet, essentially it's unfinished. The backside of that is already, you know, fairly rough. We could apply some glue just straight to that, that's fine. If we look at more of a finished leather, like this one here, it's pre-dyed. So it's got colour on the outside, it's got a little bit of finish on the outside. And it's also finished then on the flesh side as well. So it's coloured and it's kind of sealed. So when we come to preparing to actually apply the glue, we need to think about essentially whether we need to rough up the surface. If it's any kind of a shiny surface or a finished surface like this, it's going to need roughing up. If it's a reasonably, you know, smooth and shiny grain side of something like this, again, you will probably want to rough that up. So in most cases like that, you're going to want to do some kind of roughing to get the best bond. So for sake of argument, let's use this piece here. So let's say that we were going to stick this together like this. So we were going to stick the grain side to the grain side. We would want to rough that down. So to do the roughing, you can use a roughing tool such as this one. This is a Tandy one, or you can just use some sandpaper. It doesn't matter which. These roughing tools are easier than sandpaper. They've got a square edge, so you can just run them down a ruler. Or if you want to use some sandpaper, you need something reasonably coarse. That's a 320 I've just picked up there, and you can do the same thing. Just working your way down. So whatever you would use, essentially you've keyed that surface. And as always, you need to be careful not to do any sort of roughing or rubbing where you're going to see that on the finished item. So always stay well within any stitching lines that you would have. And always remove any dust that you've created. Okay, so that's preparation of the edges. You also need to consider if you're using any kind of oiled leathers or very waxy leathers or anything like that. Again, you want to, you know, do as much preparation as you can because they're going to struggle a bit more with the glue. So once you've prepared the surfaces, the next thing is to actually apply the glue. And for this test, we're going to be using the intercom because that's what I've actually bought to use for the tests. So I have that in a little pot, which we'll talk about shortly. And when we come to applying the glue, as I said earlier, there's a really a variety of things that you can use to apply these glues. The absolute best thing which I found is a silicone spreader for these kind of things. So I've got various ones here. This one is from a cooking shop because you can buy these for, you know, stirring beans and things. So kitchen shops often sell the larger ones. And if you're trying to spread out a larger area of glue, then these work well. This one with the hedgehog on. I do like the hedgehog. This is also from a kitchen shop, but I've cut it down because I was trying to make myself a smaller one. So this was originally wider. But silicone does cut easily, so I just shaved a bit off without trying to cut the hedgehog's nose. So I made myself a little bit of a thinner one, but that was also a smaller kitchen one. And then what I discovered recently, which a friend on Instagram told me about, was that actually artists sometimes use silicone brushes, which I wasn't aware of. But I believe for oil painting and things, sometimes people use silicone. So art supply shops also sometimes have silicone spreaders, which is what this one is, and this one works really well. I'll put some links down into the description for some of these things as well if you're wanting to get something like this. So any of these, depending on the area, work nicely. You can also buy these plastic type spreaders, which are very cheap. These do work okay, but not nearly as well as the silicone ones. So I would advise really against using these. They just seem to struggle to spread the glue out as well to me, those ones. And as I say, you can also use a brush. This is a brush from Renia, who do the Aquilim. But as you will see, this has actually gone rock solid. So despite me cleaning that when it's been used, it has gone rock hard. It will have to be soaked and recovered a little bit to be of any use. In terms of cleanup, the silicone spreaders are very easy to use because once you've used one of these, all you do is just run it, put it under a running tap, rub it with your thumb, and any little bits of glue will come straight off it, and that's it, 10 seconds, and you're all sorted. So these are definitely the easiest things to use. Couple of other options you have. You can use a dauber, the same as you use for dye, if you want to apply glue, especially if you're doing a larger area. There's no reason why you can't use one of those. And then if you're wanting to apply a very controlled amount of glue, the ever useful ear cleaning sticks can also be used for that. I like to use these for doing little bits of dyeing as well, but there's no reason why you can't use those for applying glue as well, as I say, especially if you're doing something in a very controlled fashion, that would work fine. So for the purposes of the demonstration here, I'll just use the silicone one. So in terms of an application, it's basically just like applying an other glue, but you need to be careful that you don't put too much on. In terms of letting this get the best bond and drying in a reasonable amount of time, it needs to be applied thin. So you don't splodge humongous amounts of glue on. It needs to be a fairly thin coat. So you would actually spread it out quite a lot and make sure that it's not too thick. And obviously I'm not applying any particular amount of glue in terms of how far it's going in because it's a test, but usually you would have some kind of a guideline to work to. Okay, so that's the kind of thing you want, a nice thin even coat. So once you've applied the glue, you need to leave it to dry. And the key word there is dry. So when you're using the solvent based glues, what you actually do is obviously let them go tacky as such. So you kind of let them partially dry, and then when they go, so they're not sticky but they're just a little bit tacky, then it's ready to be pushed together. With these water based glues, it shouldn't really feel sticky as such, it should feel as though it's dried. So you do let it go that step further before you push the pieces together. In terms of drying time, if you apply a correct amount of glue, in other words fairly thin, then it shouldn't take any more than about 5 minutes. When I spoke to the different companies making these glues, I think one company said, you know, 2 to 3 minutes. The other company said about 3 to 5 minutes. You know, if you were to give it about, you know, the 3 to 5 minutes, then that should be absolutely fine. One thing that Renia did say was, you know, when you're trying to work out if your glue's ready, try to resist kind of, you know, dabbing your finger all down the entire length of the seam to check if it's dry, because what you can do is you can transfer, you know, oils and things from your hand, from your fingers, onto the layer of glue that you've just made, and that can actually stop the glues sticking together. So if you do need to give it a little bit of a test, you know, make sure you're somewhere less critical, so not right at the edge. You would maybe test it in a little bit somewhere where it didn't matter, or just avoid doing it altogether, really. And if you struggle a little bit with the time and you get a little bit impatient, one tip that I can give you is if you've got a you know, a smartphone or a smartwatch or a smart speaker or something like that, whether it's a Google one or an iPhone or something, they will all do countdown timers for you. So you can just ask it to do a 5 minute countdown, and that'll save you getting impatient and doing it too early. Okay, so once you've given the glue time to dry, and as I say, you shouldn't normally be touching it all, but I will just demonstrate that, for example, if I put my finger on there, it's not tacky like a contact one would be, where you can then lift it up off the page. It's dry enough that I can't actually stick it to my finger, if you like, but it's had its few minutes. You then just press and hammer exactly the same as you would with a solvent-based adhesive. So you place those edges together, press with your thumb, press with your fingers. Take your cobbler's hammer. I won't hammer this because the hammering noise annoys people, but you would then hammer down the seam as well. So the, you know, the actual pushing together of the pieces is exactly the same. And that's it. That's all there is to the actual demonstration. It's worth noting that the strength improves over time as well. So it can take up to a couple of days for these water-based ones to fully cure off and gain the maximum strength. But once you've, you know, once it's dried and you've pushed it together, as long as you're not putting any great stress on it, you should be able, okay, to carry on with your project or do your stitching or whatever you need to do. Okay, so the last thing to talk about before we finish is storing the glue. So as you can see, what I've got here is a glass Kilner jar. That's a brand make, but you know, you can get these all over the place, these style of things. Essentially, it's a sealed glass jar, and what I've done is I've taken the container of glue that I bought and I've decanted some into this glass jar. So there's a few reasons to do that. Firstly, if you wanted to glue a larger area, so you wanted to use something like this big spatula, you'll find that that doesn't fit into the neck of the you know, the normal jar. I can't get a spatula in there, whereas if you're using something like this, because it's much bigger, I can get that spatula in there and I can get as much glue as I want. Also, as I mentioned earlier, because these are water-based, it is possible for them to grow, you know, mold or bacteria or get contaminated in some way. So if you were to accidentally contaminate the glue in here and you found it had gone bad, you could obviously throw that away and clean your jar out and then get some fresh glue out of your pot, so you wouldn't be wasting the whole pot. Whereas if you're dipping in and out of a big pot all the time and you get, you know, get something in it that turns it bad, you've wasted the whole pot. So whatever it is that you're storing your glue in, you should generally keep it out of sunlight, again, because that can encourage any sorts of bacteria to grow. So keep it in a drawer or something rather than, you know, on a windowsill. You want it to be not too cold, so don't let it freeze.
and you also don't want it to be too hot, like most things. Not a problem in England and things like that, but if you lived in a very, very hot country, obviously try and make sure it doesn't get, you know, too hot. And that's it really. I think that's everything I've got to tell you. As I say, the video's probably ended up really long because there's actually a ton of information there, really. It's more of a complex topic than you think when you start looking into it. So if you're wanting to, you know, try one of these newer type of water-based glues, hopefully you've got all the information there you need to make a decision about which one you want to try and, you know, where to go about making a start with that. And as I say, if you are, you know, stuck in your ways, no pun intended, and you want to stay with the older solvent type glues because you're happy with it and you can get it, then as long as you're aware of the potential issues with that, then that's absolutely fine as well. You can use whatever you want to use. But as I say, I think going forward into the future, we're going to probably see more and more usage of this water-based stuff. So I'm happy to try and jump on that particular bandwagon now, I think, and hopefully I won't have any problems. Okay, so I hope that's been useful, and I'll see you in the next video.